Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning in the old cookbook show. Today, we're going to do a recipe out of this little cookbook sent in by a viewer. Thank you very much for sending this to us, and thank you to everyone who sends us cookbooks. Absolutely love getting these in the mail and going through them, and they start to put little pieces of the puzzle together. And you're able to, the more cookbooks that I have, the more that I'm able to connect the dots of recipes as they go back through time. To me, it's really fascinating to watch how recipes change, how the names change, and they move forward. This little cookbook, though, it's called the Little Gem Recipe Book. It was given out by the Marshall Supply Company, the Friendly Store in Marshall, Texas, a hardware store in Marshall, Texas. And the thing about this cookbook is the recipes inside are relatively unremarkable. They're meant to sort of capture the imagination of the broadest audience possible. And the thing about this cookbook is that it's published by an advertising agency in Chicago. Now, the idea is this ad agency in Chicago worked as sort of a middle company between the companies that made stuff sold in hardware stores and hardware stores that were looking to promote their products. So what would have happened is this hardware store in Marshall, Texas, would have gone to the Bunting system in Chicago, Illinois, and said, we want a promotional item that we can give out to our customers. And the Bunting system had a catalog with a bunch of different types of cookbooks. And so this hardware store would have said, we want cookbook A or cookbook 35 or whatever the number was. And then the Bunting system would look at them and say, okay, now we've got another catalog, and in that catalog are all of these little ads that you see in the front and back. And so the hardware store would pick out, they'd say, yeah, we sell roller skates made by Winchester. Put one of those ads in. Yeah, we sell Johnson's Wax. Put one of those ads in. Yes, we sell Master Padlocks, etc., etc., etc. And so then the Bunting system would print up this, and they'd give it out to their customers. At the same time, this is happening in Marshall, Texas. These exact same little cookbooks are being handed out by hardware stores across the United States. And so this same cookbook, with different ads, would have been handed out in New York City or Chicago or LA, anywhere in rural America. And so the recipes inside needed to be, as I said, relatively unremarkable. They needed to appeal to a very broad general audience. So it's kind of like, I don't know how old you are, but maybe you remember in the 70s and 80s, KTEL records, the greatest hits records that you would buy. I'm dating myself. And this is sort of that. So a lot of recipes in here that would appeal to a rural crowd, and recipes that would appeal to a more city crowd or urban crowd. And I'm sure that they'd both sort of look at some of these recipes and go, I don't know about that, but there's a bunch that they would really enjoy. So today we're making caramel flavored sugar cookies. I've already, because I really like cookies, why wouldn't I make cookies? I've already creamed the butter and I'm going to cream in the two sugars. So in goes white granulated sugar and some brown sugar. So I've got some flour, and to that I'm adding salt and baking soda. Just give that a little bit of a stir. Now this is the first time I've come across one of these little cookbooks from the Bunting system, and I'm really interested in getting my hands on a few more of them. This one is from 1937, and apparently they started in 1930 and they went on. I'm trying to find the end date. Sometimes it's difficult to find, and I haven't come up with one that is one that I believe yet. I've come across five or six different dates of when they ended. So I'm looking for more of these books, and I want to sort of trace some of these recipes back. I filmed an episode yesterday of another recipe from this book, and it was a colossal failure. Well, that didn't work. I guess I'll have to start over. A colossal failure. So I'm interested in where this ad agency got these recipes from. Are they recipes that they've just picked out of newspapers? Are they recipes that they've picked out of other cookbooks? There's no protection for a recipe, no copyright protection for a recipe. So they are free to take the recipe from anywhere and put it into their own cookbook. And so I'm kind of curious as to where the recipes came from. This is going to provide me with hours of enjoyment, as are these cookies, I think. So I'm just going to scrape down the sides, because even with the scraper, it's a good idea just to make sure everything is getting mixed together. Now, I'll crack in the eggs one at a time. And it wouldn't surprise me if in 1937, when this book was published, that some of the hardware stores would be selling this KitchenAid mixer. This mixer had been on the market for almost 20 years by this point. And even though it was the Great Depression, KitchenAid couldn't keep up with production. These things were flying off the shelves. You think of it as something that nobody needs, really. Nobody needs one. It's something that you want. And yet, at the height of the Great Depression, they couldn't keep them in stock. So, eggs one at a time. Now, I'm going to spoon the flour mixture in a little bit at a time, just until it's fully incorporated. Don't go too fast, but don't go too slow. I guess you have to find that perfect spot. And if you're not comfortable doing this in a mixer, do it by hand. I know some people get freaked out about putting flour into a mixer, that it's going to be overbeaten and it's going to change the structure of the dough. I don't have those same fears. All mixed in. Now, this needs to chill in the refrigerator. It doesn't say how long, but I'm supposed to roll it out and cut it with a cookie cutter. So I'm going to put it in the fridge for probably a half an hour or so. See you back here in a little bit. Now, before I roll this out, I'm just going to put a little bit of flour on my bench here, just to make sure it doesn't stick. Put that out. And it says to roll it to a fourth of an inch. And this might take a little bit. I'm going to say that's a quarter inch. Now, I'm supposed to sprinkle some sugar on top. And I've got Demerara sugar here. I really like Demerara sugar. A little bit bigger crystal, and there's a couple of different kinds of Demerara that you can buy. There's a really kind of almost wet kind that's a really dark brown sugar. And then there's this one that's more of a crystal. Put this on. Doesn't say how much. Just to your own liking. And then roll it in with the pin just to make sure it sticks. Just like that. Okay. Take a cutter and cut some cookies. I'm only going to bake probably half of them. The other half won't go in the oven. They'll just go onto a baking tray like this into the freezer, where I can freeze them, and then I'll wrap them up later. And then just bake them from frozen whenever you need cookies. Because this apparently makes 40, but anytime a cookie recipe gives you a number, it's so dependent on how big you make them, how big a round. In this case, I'm using for a cookie cutter, how thick you roll them in this case. If they're drop cookies, how big you're dropping them. So always take those numbers with a bit of a grain of salt. And I don't imagine that I have to space them out too far on the baking tray. I don't think they're going to expand much. And into the oven at 350 degrees.
Hey, Glen, still reading your cookbooks? Hey, friends.
Shrimp and tomato aspic. But the one below it, the jellied tuna salad. A package of lemon jello. With paprika, a can of tuna or lobster, and mayonnaise. Now,
yeah, the lemon jello seems a little, the lemon jello kind of throws me. I could see maybe using gelatin to firm it up, but.
Yeah, lemon jello?
But lemon and fish go together?
They do. That's
true. I don't
know
about the sugariness of it. That's an unusual one. Has anyone ever done this before?
Yes.
We'd like to know more.
I mean, but it's something that my, grandmother would have tormented me with at family functions in the 70s, right?
Along with the aspic?
Yes. So these are caramel-flavored sugar cookies. And
they are
just a simple sugar cookie. I mean, there's nothing.
And then the joy of being a sugar cookie.
Not really caramel. It's that hit from the brown sugar.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
But, cup of tea. It's all good.
Amazing. Amazing. They could, you could dress it up a little bit with maybe a little cinnamon or maybe a little nutmeg.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
A little cinnamon on top even.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So a solid cookie from a cookbook that has some other recipes that aren't so solid. And you saw a little bit of my fail with another recipe from this book. So sometimes it's the recipe, sometimes it's the cook. Sometimes it's the recipe and the cook. Who knows?
And sometimes it's just not something you like.
It's not something you like. But they didn't work out, the other recipe. I'm not even going to talk
about it.
These did. These are good.
One's gone.
Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.